Thank you, Carsten. Thank you for the flowers. It's probably said a little bit too much, but thank you. Yeah, so I have to speak about mass spectroscopy, which is a little bit exotic in the bioinorganic toolbox, but nevertheless it contributes to all these parameters that we need if we want to understand electronic structure of transition metal complexes. And it works very nice with iron. It works, yeah, best for iron. And the history of iron and bioinorganic chemistry is already pretty old. It started shortly after this effect, this Mössbauer effect, had been discovered in nuclear physics. A few years later, people recorded these Mössbauer spectra of blood cells, so the hemoglobin, the iron and hemoglobin was recorded. And I will walk you through this, the principles and the basics of this method, which shows lines which going downward, and there is a funny energy scale in millimeters per second. All these things we have to address now and hopefully understand a little bit later at the end of this talk. The method is named after Rudolf Mössbauer, who actually got the Nobel Prize for his PhD work. And I think there is, I heard that this, I never saw it, but I think this paper was, or this work, this PhD thesis was something like 27 pages or so. So that can be worth a Nobel Prize. What is what he calls nuclear or nuclear gamma spectroscopy, resonance absorption of gamma radiation. And that is what we can see here. I forgot to look for the pointer. Is there a pointer here? Oh no, sorry, may I have this one? It's so it's nuclear and it's gamma radiation involved. So that means we are talking about nuclear levels, and our favorite isotope, our favorite nucleus which we have to talk about is iron 57. That is a stable isotope. And if we assume that by some means we bring it into a nuclear excited state, this nuclear excited state will not live forever, but it will decay after something like 100 nanoseconds, and then gamma radiation is emitted. And under certain circumstances, this gamma radiation can be reabsorbed. And if this happens, then one can call it gamma resonance absorption. And why should we be interested in this thing? And the reason for that is that these nuclear levels have a very long lifetime. They are incredibly sharp, and that can, or that gives us the possibility to see hyperfine splitting of these nuclear levels. And the method is used for measuring these splittings and these shifts and hyperfine interaction. You heard already this morning is always a combination of a nuclear property and an electronic property. We know the nuclear properties in this case, so we can learn something about the electronic properties which cause these levels. So the levels are very sharp, I said. As usual in spectroscopy, the ground state lives forever, so it's sharp. The excited state is has a certain line width, and the lifetime for this iron 57 nucleus gives us then a line width of 4.6 nano electron volts. And this one has to see in comparison with the energy of the excited state, which is at 14 kilo electron volts. So that is an incredible energy resolution. Actually, we will need that, and actually there is a problem with this high energy resolution, namely, and that was worth the Nobel Prize to understand finally. So if you have a nucleus and this nucleus emits a gamma photon, this gamma photon has a momentum. So momentum has to be conserved during the decay. That means the nucleus will take a recoil. It will be shooted back with a little bit. And if we look at the energies involved in this process, we see that the recoil energy depends on the nuclear energy to the square. And if we put in numbers for this for these expressions, we will see that this recoil energy, which is then missing in the energy of the photon, is much larger than the line widths. So if we have 14 kilo electron volts excited state and 4-5 nano electron widths, the recoil is 2 milli electron volts. So no chance to reabsorb, to have this nuclear gamma resonance for free nuclei or atoms in gases and liquids. And the solution for this problem is, if we have a nucleus in a solid, or if we have a Mossberg atom in a solid, then the elastic forces around the nucleus under some conditions can force this little crystallite to take the recoil. And then we have 10 to the 12, 10 to the 15 or so atoms involved in such a process. The mass is huge, and then the recoil disappears. And understanding the relation between this gamma radiation and the elastic properties of solids, that was worth the Nobel Prize, actually. And since then, this effect is called Mossberg effect. If one does the proper theory, one can show that this recoil is zero, as I said already. But at the end, one will have a Debye-Waller factor, or a Lamb-Mossberg factor, as it's called in this spectroscopy, to describe the intensity and the dependence, or let's say to describe the property for recoilless emission and absorption, and that controls the intensity also of the Mossberg spectra. So we have very sharp levels, but we want to do, and we have very, very monochromatic light according to this conditions, but how to do a spectroscopy with that? We have no chance to to manipulate the nucleus. Actually, we have to have the same nuclei in the light source and in our sample, the absorber. They have to be the same nuclei because of these extremely sharp levels. But how to do a spectroscopy? So we have to do an energy modulation during the decay or after the decay. And that is done by Doppler effect. That is simply done by moving the source towards or away from the sample during the measurement. This Doppler effect you all know from acoustics, but it works also in with light. And if we have such a picture now where we have a radioactive source which emits the light, and after a certain time the wavefront arrange arrives at a certain distance, and if we move the source during that time, we compress the wave train a little bit, the wavelength decreases and the energy increases. And that is the way how this energy modulation is done. And it depends whether we move towards the absorber or away from the absorber. We increase or decrease the energy. And therefore, a Mossberg spectrometer, in principle, is a very simple instrument. We need a radioactive source. The sample is the absorber. And we need only a detector to detect the intensity of this light transmitted through this absorber, and we have to move the source, and then we can measure the transmission of this radiation as a function of this velocity. And that is the reason why these Mossberg spectra have this funny energy unit, millimeters per second. In a more microscopic picture, it is such that we modulate the energy according to the expression of Doppler, where we have a modulation in units of velocity divided by the speed of light. And now guess how large this velocity has to be to bring this setup into resonance or out of resonance. It's only millimeters per second. Actually, it's a fraction of a millimeter per second, which we need to do that. Yeah, so by changing this energy, we can probe actually the profile of the excited state. If the modulated gamma energy is shorter, the probability for extra absorption by the nucleus is zero, or if it is very large, if it ends up here, the probability is zero. But as long as it hits this profile, we have a certain additional probability for nuclear absorption. Now, this is always on top of the normal mass absorption in the sample, but it's this resonant absorption alone which depends on little motion of the radioactive source. Yeah, in the practicals you will see and learn a little bit more about the setup. So I mentioned already the the sample, which usually for a practical experiment, in particular in bioinorganic chemistry or biochemistry, we have to freeze the sample. I explained that it has to be a solid. We cannot measure on a solution material, on a liquid, on a fluid solution, but we have to freeze the sample or have a powder. We have the Mössbauer drive unit, we have the detection system, and we need electronics to drive to make this this velocity profile for the recording, and we have the gamma, some gamma electronics and some recording electronics that we need. I think this is a picture out of Carsten's lecture from last year, so I hope it's the setup that you are going to use this year again. So that is a practical setup with a cryostat, so this pot here with this tail section that is a cryostat for liquid helium, liquid nitrogen, I guess. That is a Mössbauer motor, so this velocity transducer, and here is some better detector behind this thing. And the whole thing is it's properly shielded so that nobody is exposed to the radiation, to the ionizing radiation, when the system is operating. We have to say a little bit about the light source. I mentioned already, due to the narrow lines of the nuclear levels, we need to have the same isotope in light source and in the absorber. And iron-57 as a stable isotope has to come to the excited state, and that can be achieved in a reasonable manner by using a nuclear decay cascade. So we are starting with radioactive cobalt-57. This does a very funny decay. It's not alpha decay, not beta decay, but it's K-capturing. The cobalt-57 nucleus is able to capture eventually an electron, an K-electron out of the K-shell in the nucleus, and we have a nuclear reaction of an electron on the proton forming a neutron. That means the material afterwards is not longer cobalt anymore, but it has shifted in the periodic table, so it's iron. Iron 57 then in the excited state, and the first excited state that is reached is at 136 kilo electron volt, and that can decay to the ground state. In principle, one can do Mössbauer spectroscopy with this transition, but it's quite unfavored due to the relatively high gamma energy. That means the recoil energy was this energy to the square. Therefore, the Debye-Waller factor for these transitions will be pretty, pretty small. It was measured once, but it doesn't give pleasure. So we wait for a transition to this first excited state at 14 kilo electron volts, and we use then the subsequent transition to the ground state. So this 14 kilo electron volt is our Mössbauer level. And that's the way, or that is the reason why we need always for every different isotope, we need a different radioactive source. So we cannot simply switch from one isotope to the other. And in addition, we need electronics, and that you will also learn eventually in the practicals. We need electronics to reject pulses which we do not want. Now we want to do this Mössbauer transmission experiment with these 14 kilo electron volt pulses, but these are always coming, and they have to be rejected in the electronic system. So that is a thing for the practical. So I want to emphasize again that the sample in normal experiments is not radioactive. We have iron-57 that is naturally abundant by about 2%, and small molecules like synthetic porphyrins or other model complexes in bioinorganic chemistry can be measured as a powder without enrichment. If you want to measure a protein with a molecular weight of 5 to 25 or 1,000 Dalton, one has to enrich in iron-57. We like to have something like 1 millimolar concentration. I know this is a cruel thing for many of you. So if you bargain, I think we go down to, Carsten should say, I shouldn't spoil the prizes here. Let's say 0.5 millimolar. Yeah. Okay, we can now ask, what makes up a good Mössbauer isotope? Why is iron-57 such a unique case? The first thing, we need a low-lying nuclear level. I talked about 14 kilo electron volts. You probably know that in nuclear physics, most energies in nuclear physics are mega electron volts. So this is an unusual isotope, if you like, or a nucleus. We need a long lifetime in order to have sharp lines. That's the same as in relaxation in magnetic resonance. We need a source available. We need a suitable nuclear spin. This nuclear spin we need in order to have a splitting of these levels for which we want to measure the hyperfine interaction. That should be not too small and not too large. If it is too large, then we have too much overlapping spectra. If it is too small, we don't learn anything. And we need suitable hyperfine coupling constants. And if we summarize all this thing and look at the periodic table of a Mesbauer spectroscopist, iron 57 is clearly the very best isotope we can have. There are spectrometers running for ruthenium, or even nickel is available. That is very unpleasant in a way that the lines are broad, and for one of the isotopes which are possible, there are two isotopes actually for nickel which can be used, but one of them has a lifetime of only a few days, so one needs to have an accelerator next door to make the radioactive source, do a little bit hot chemistry, and then measure for a few hours, and then go back and do that again. Others which are working fine are iodine, but I think in bioinorganic chemistry, that's not the hit. And in the lanthanides or so, there are quite a few. Dysprosium is quite a nice Mesbauer isotope that's interesting in single molecule magnets, but not in bioinorganic chemistry. Okay, so we stick to iron here. And this is, in principle, a summary of all the hyperfine pattern that we can measure with iron Mesbauer spectroscopy. The nuclear levels are labeled by these nuclear spins of 3/2. That means the excited state is a quartet, and spin 1/2 in the ground state, so that is a doublet. And these levels can shift and can split under the influence of electric and magnetic interactions with the electronic shell. And what we can have first is a shift of these levels that is then called the Mesbauer isomer shift. And that means that the resonance at the end of such a single line, you know, the levels are still unsplit, that the resonance is not occurring at zero Doppler modulation, but it happens at a different velocity, at a different Doppler velocity. Next, we can have a so-called, so that is the isomer shift. Then we can have a so-called electric quadrupole interaction. This quadrupole interaction leads to a splitting of the excited state only, because the ground state nuclei with spin 1/2 don't have a quadrupole moment. The excited level splits in two doublets. That's like a zero-field splitting in the electronic shell. And we have two possibilities for a transition, and then the transmission spectrum has two lines, like this one. So the splitting of these two lines is the quadrupole splitting in the excited state, and on top of the splitting, one has always the shift of the spectrum. So the combination of isomer shift and quadrupole interaction or magnetic interaction is always easy, because the isomer shift is always additive, simply. And the third interaction that we have is now magnetic in nature, that is related to EPR and paramagnetic NMR. So if the nucleus is in a magnetic field, either from an applied magnetic field or from a paramagnetic moment in the electronic shell or a magnetic phase in solid material, we will have a total lift of these levels due to nuclear Zeeman effect in the excited state and in the ground state, and together with a certain selection rule that the magnetic quantum number should change by zero or plus or minus one, we have, in such a case, we have six allowed transitions, and then the Mesbauer spectrum is such a six-line pattern. I think there's no time to talk much about the intensity ratio, but if we have a powder distribution of magnetic fields, we have such an intensity ratio of 3:2:1, and I think in the practice you will see examples where this can be 3:4:1 or 3:0:1. So with the relative intensities of the line of the magnetic spectrum, one can learn something about the orientation of the magnetic field with respect to the gamma ray. Okay, so these are the basic pattern, and what we learned from these parameters is the Altmer shift gives information about the charge density at the iron nucleus. The quadrupole splitting tells something about electric charge asymmetry, and the magnetic hyperfine interaction about spin at the nucleus, spin density around the nucleus, or dipole interaction, and so on. And these are the parameters which we then do interpretation with in terms of valence state, symmetry, ligand covalency, and so on, which we can call chemical information. To emphasize again, the technique is highly selective. It works only with iron, or it reports only about iron. Whatever is in the sample, only iron is seen, and it shows information about all iron. It's not dependent on the electronic spin state and so on, or the oxidation state. It gives information about the oxidation state, but it works always, and it yields very local information, like always with this hyperfine interaction. It tells something about the nearest neighbors, and eventually the next nearest neighbors, and then we get blind. This can be an advantage or a disadvantage, depending on what you are looking for. Okay, now the hyperfine interactions in a little bit more detail. The Altmer shift is related to the fact that the nucleus is something like a charged sphere in a cloud of electrons. You know that from electrochemistry, for instance, that has a certain electrostatic potential, a certain contribution to the total energy is coming from the electrostatic interaction of this arrangement. And now it happens that the nuclear radius changes upon the nuclear transition. So it's a little bit larger in the ground state than in the excited state. And that means this electrostatic contribution to the total energy of these levels is slightly different. So when we look at this figure, if we wouldn't have a charge around the nucleus, we would have these levels, and now we have little shifts of these levels in the excited and in the ground state. And it becomes a little bit more complicated, and these differences change when the charge density changes around the nucleus. The nuclear property is always the same, but the charge density, that changes from sample to sample, and it's different for the radioactive source and for the absorber. So it's a difference of differences that we measure at the end, and the Altmer shifts always have to be referred to either to the source material or to a reference absorber, but that is the background of this business. Okay. So one can express that certainly also in terms of an expression. So the Altmer shift depends on a nuclear property, that is this variation or this difference in radius of the nucleus in the excited and the ground state, and depends on the difference of the charge density, electric charge density in source and absorber. That is a little bit too complicated, so we can simplify that for the practical cases that the Altmer shift is proportional to a proportionality constant, which happens to be negative for iron, times the charge density at the nucleus and the constant. A sort of problem is now that the orbitals which we are mostly interested in, namely the valence orbital, the 3D orbitals, don't have charge at the nucleus. Only S orbitals have charge at the nucleus. And that means we have to do some more complicated interpretation when we measure an Altmer shift. The classical way to do an interpretation is that we talk about shielding effects of the 3D electrons on the nuclear potential for the S orbitals. So if we increase the D charge, the nuclear potential is more shielded, the S orbitals expand, and the charge density goes down, and because we have this negative alpha here, the Altmer shift goes up. This effect exists, but it's by far not the strongest effect. One can do quantum chemical calculations, and Frank has shown very nicely in 2002 that if we make a plot of the isomer shift, or the, if we make a plot of the variations of the charge density at the nucleus for a whole series of compound which reaches from an iron 2 hexaqua complex to this iron 6 particle, that the variation of the charge density is mainly caused by the 4S contribution. That which you normally in a basic crystal field or ligand field picture is not even touched or is not even used and mentioned. So it is in the molecular orbital picture, it's the 4S contribution which shows the largest variation. But at the end, one comes to relatively comparable expressions for understanding the variation or the chemical relation between isomer shift and oxidation state and spin state and so on. Here is a radial function or the shape of a 4S contribution, the radial distribution of an orbital which makes which contributes mainly the 4S part at the nucleus. For this fluoride complexes, iron 2 and iron 3, and chemists know that they have different bond distances, so the iron fluoride bonds are different, and that is reflected here. The fluoride nucleus is sitting at these two minima of this plot, and at the end, this compression or expansion of the bond changes this s orbital, so that in the 1s region, that means at the nucleus, we have the strongest variation. So and at the end, one can show that the best parameter to correlate the isomer shift with is the bond distance. Bond distance is then related to spin state, to oxidation state, and so on. So if one does an empirical plot of all iron compounds ever measured, one finds this diagram. So there is the isomer shift for iron 3, iron 2, and more exotic cases, iron 4 should be mentioned, iron 5 should be mentioned, and so on. And one can see that there's quite a big scattering of the values for iron 3 low spin or iron 3 high spin. But if we take all the high spin complexes, for instance, we have clearly such a trend in this data. And if we take a difference between, or if you take the low spin and the high spin complexes for iron 2 and iron 3, we also have a difference. And I think that should be understandable. Why is the isomer shift of an iron 2 low spin smaller than the isomer shift of an iron 2 high spin? Now that has to do with these bond distances. Which one has the shorter bond? Low spin or high spin? Come on.
Low spin.
Certainly has the shorter bond. Now the shorter bond compresses the orbitals, increases the charge density at the nucleus, and decreases the isomer shift. The same argument can be done for this oxidation state dependence. Now if I make such plots, such correlation diagrams, not over all compounds that are available, but if you stay to a certain ligand system, if you stay to porphyrins or cyclam or whatever, and then make, for instance, an oxidation state variation, then we get a very nice correlation of the isomer shift and the oxidation state. And Nicolai has shown that for his nitrosyl complexes a few minutes ago. There was a very nice correlation, very straight. Must not be like that, but one can have it. So in summary, we have a dependence of the isomer shift on the oxidation state. So the number of 3D electrons at the iron, that apparently changes the isomer shift also. The coordination number changes. No? 4 coordinated compounds have shorter bonds than 6 coordinated compounds. The spin state we discussed about. The nature of the ligand apparently is also important, whether we have a soft or a hard ligand matters. And if we compare oxygen and sulfur ligands, for instance, sulfur compounds have much shorter and have much shorter bonds and have lower isomer shifts. I have a few slides in the collection which you then see in the PDFs, which I will not go too deep in, but this is a summary of what, for instance, can happen for iron 2 high spin complexes, 6 coordinated and 4 coordinated, with oxygen, nitrogen, and chloride, and this is the trend in the isomer shift that we have for such a system. Or if we go over from a 6 coordination to a 4 coordination, the isomer shift drops due to this shortening of the bond lengths. And if we go over from chloride to sulfide, we again have a drop in the isomer shift. So these are typical trends. That works quite nicely with high oxidation states and high spin states. And unfortunately, this trend fades when it comes to low valent, low spin complexes. If we take the classical ferri and ferrocyanide complexes with 6 CN ligands, we have a very similar isomer shift. And I mean, it is mentioned here. But what is the reason? I mean, a chemist knows also the same trend from the bond length. Now, if you compare such complexes, one cannot use the bond length for determining a spin state. People like Carl Wickert always could tell the spin state from looking at a structure of a coordination compound, but with cyanide complexes that does not work. No? And that is due to back donation, or the change in back donation in these complexes changes, so to say, the primary effects in the valence shell. Therefore, these trends fade and one cannot use that. That can be even reversed. So Conilu, for instance, has quite a number of complexes in which the trend in the isomer shift is in principle opposite. It's counterintuitive, what we see there. And Schenkfar in Mülheim has nicely shown in detail how such what the origin of this difference can be with Jonas-Peters complexes. A more biochemical example here, what we can see is a very old example. iron sulfur spectra, you know the iron sulfur clusters, the dinuclear iron sulfur clusters have typical Mössbauer pattern that was measured already in 75 by Johnson. And you see, that is the Mössbauer spectrum of an oxidized dinuclear iron sulfur cluster that has an isomer shift of 0.27. That is typical for such a 4 coordination with sulfur. And when the system gets reduced, the Mössbauer spectrum is a superposition of the former doublet plus a new doublet with a much higher isomer shift. It's the isomer shift of this blue labeled thing or of these doublets is always in the middle of between the two lines. So that has a higher isomer shift of 0.54. So that is the difference that we can have with this iron 2 and iron 3 systems sulfur coordinated. Okay, isomer shift was the first interaction. Now a little bit more about quadrupole interaction, quadrupole splitting. The quadrupole interaction results from the rotational energy of a quadrupole moment in an electric field gradient. So it's the asymmetry of the electric charge distribution around the nucleus, which determines this quadrupole interaction. So that makes the splitting of the Mössbauer spectrum. And so this rotational energy is quantized, and then the nuclear quadrupole moment has two orientations, which are possible for this excited state. And then we have this situation that the excited levels split like this one, and we have this doublet. So that quadrupole splitting depends on the quadrupole moment, that's the nuclear property, and it depends on the electric field gradient. Electric field gradient is a little bit nasty property, it's a tensor. And from this tensor, we need only to know two components, namely the largest component, the main component, and the asymmetry parameter, which is the difference between the other two. I will not deepen that now, but I will talk a little bit more about what charge asymmetry produces which electric field gradient. And it's clear if we have the gradient is a variation of the electric field in space. So it's clear if we have an S-type that there is no preferential orientation, so there cannot be an electric field gradient at the nucleus. So in this case, this main component is zero. If we elongate the charge distribution, then we have an electric field gradient and the main component is negative. you have to believe me now. And if the charge distribution is more oblate, it's more like a pancake, then we have a positive VZZ component as this main component is shown. And I show you this distribution because if you now close your eyes a little bit, you can see some similarity of this charge distribution with d orbitals. If you look at the shape of d orbitals, it's clear this one is an elongated charge distribution that will have a negative electric field gradient if an electron is sitting in that one. If we have an x square minus y square orbital, we have a positive electric field gradient. And such an electron in such an orbital, in an ionic case, would produce a quadrupole splitting of about 4 millimeters per second. And one can calculate these expectation values for the electric quadrupole splitting for these d orbitals from the angular distribution of these orbitals. And then one has these factors which you eventually have seen already in ligand field theory or so, which are 4 over 7 and 2 over 7 for these different orbitals. And we can focus here now on the VZZ component of this tensor because we always stick in our explanation in a normal classical ligand field approach that we start with quasi-octahedral explanation and stick then first to the C-axis and then we add more perturbations to this system. Okay, and for a n electron system, we simply add up these numbers to get the total, what we call valence contribution to the electric field gradient. And if we look at an iron 3 high spin, let's say with an orbit splitting like this one, what will be the electric field gradient of this system, this valence contribution? It must be zero. When you look through the table, we have all the numbers zero, but it is also zero in a very simple symmetry approach. When you look at the 5d orbitals all stacked in one box, we have a cubic arrangement, so there's no preferential orientation. The electric field gradient must be zero. So the so-called valence contribution is zero. It's the quadrupole splitting is roughly zero. It's small. It may be 0.5, 0.3 or so millimeters per second. Yeah? But the situation will change when we have one extra electron. If we go over to iron 2, if we reduce the system, then we have 5 electrons which in sum do contribute nothing to the valence contribution, but the 6th electron then will control the quadrupole splitting and even the size of this quadrupole split, the sign of this quadrupole splitting and so on. And here the same spectrum which we have seen before now about the quadrupole splitting. You see that is a quadrupole splitting for an iron 3 in this quasi-tetrahedral arrangement. And the blue one is the quadrupole splitting for iron 2 in the octahedral arrangement. I think I skip the next two examples and go over to magnetic mass power spectrum. We had seen already the Zeeman splitting of these levels lifts the degeneracy of the excited state and the ground state totally, and I explained that we have 6 lines which we can see. Why don't we see magnetic mass power spectra even if we have paramagnetic compounds? The reason is that unless we go to very low temperature and apply a certain magnetic field at high temperature, the field at the nucleus averages practically to zero. Now, if we are measuring at 80 Kelvin, the Zeeman effect is such a weak interaction, so a field of the Earth magnetic field or a field of a few kilogauss applied in the lab is not sufficient to split the magnetic levels of the electronic shell in such a manner that the Boltzmann business left over a sizable magnetic moment. If the magnetic relaxation, I should say, is fast on the nuclear timescale. If it would be large, then it would be different. But for paramagnetic compounds, we don't see magnetic spectra unless we go to low temperature and eventually apply a magnetic field. The situation is a little bit different when we have magnetic phases. For instance, if we take these minerals, goethite, so Fe2O3 and Fe3O4, they show magnetic mass power spectra at room temperature. Very sharp lines, because here in these magnetic domains, the magnetic field at the nuclei are static. So we get nice, sharp, qu- quadruple splitting, and three for this magnetite, which is a spinel, and they have different iron 2 and iron 3 sites, and then this total magnetic splitting is different for these different cases. And finally, in bioinorganic chemistry, there are these magnetotactic bacteria, which form some magnetite particles as compass needles in their cells. And if we take the Mössbauer spectrum of this one, we can easily show that this is magnetite. This is probably not the most favorite application that we are interested in. By the way, Carsten, how much time do I have? When did I start? I thought it was half. No? Okay, I go on. So we have to talk now when we go into magnetic spectra, and I saw that in the practicals you will also work on paramagnetic Mössbauer spectra. But for understanding these, we have to understand a little bit combined hyperfine interaction. So isomer shift, I told, is easy. That is always additive. But the quadrupole splitting and the magnetic hyperfine interaction, they are difficult to explain. And usually in the general case, one cannot even predict how the spectra look like in an easy manner. One can do that in a perturbation situation. So if one of these interactions is larger than the others. So if we start with a situation where we have a strong magnetic field at the nucleus, and in a paramagnetic compound that can be easily 50 Tesla. No, so that is a typical value for iron 3 high spin, 50 Tesla at the nucleus. Then we have this dominant magnetic splitting, and now the quadrupole splitting adds as a perturbation in the sense that the levels with the magnetic quantum number Mi plus 3/2 and minus 3/2 are shifted in one direction, as it was in the quadrupole interaction, in the pure quadrupole interaction, and the other two, plus and minus 1/2, shifting down. And nothing happens in the ground state, no quadrupole interaction there. And the result is a magnetic six-line pattern in which the outer two lines are shifted relative to the inner four lines. And from the difference in these lines 1 and 2 and 5 and 6, we learn something about the quadrupole shift. It gives the quadrupole shift. And that is even nicer. It gives also the sign of the quadrupole interaction. In the pure quadrupole doublet, symmetric quadrupole doublet in a powder sample, I cannot determine which line is which. So that can be positive or negative. But with an applied magnetic, or with a field present at the nucleus, we can determine the sign of the quadrupole interaction. And that will also be quite an essential step in this paramagnetic spectra simulation. The second case also can be argued about, namely if the quadrupole interaction is larger than the magnetic interaction. So if we have a dominant quadrupole interaction and we apply, for instance, a static magnetic field in the lab, then we can generate now additional magnetic splitting of these doublets here and here. And if the field gradient was positive, the plus minus three half levels are up, and they split three times larger than the plus minus 1/2 levels. The ground levels also split. And it's funny with these nuclei, you see, they have different nuclear G factors in the ground state and in the excited state, and even the sign of these G factors are different. So nuclei can have negative G factors and so on. And if we then go through the allowed transitions, we will see that the former quadrupole doublet now splits in a pattern of virtually two lines and four lines on the other side. And here again, we can recognize the sign of the quadrupole interaction, namely if that would be the other way around, these levels would be rotated and the quadrupole spectrum would be rotated. Okay. So we again learn something about the sign of the quadrupole interaction. I touch now briefly paramagnetic Mössbauer spectroscopy. That is probably possible if zero field splitting and Yeah, and magnetic properties of something like iron 3 had been touched this morning. I wasn't quite sure. So if we take this example of iron 3 high spin and we make the comparison with EPR spectroscopy, the electrostatic interaction and spin orbit interaction of this iron 3 or this 3D6 configuration of the iron 3 high spin leads to a zero field splitting of the ground state of this 6s ion. That is mixing of the excited orbitals, that is due to mixing of the excited orbital states into the ground state that generates such a zero field splitting as it is shown here. And applying a magnetic field lifts this splitting by Zeeman effect. And one can see that this magnetic splitting depends now very much on the orientation of the magnetic field with respect to the quantization axis of the zero field interaction. So that is, for instance, here, according to the magnetic quantum numbers with fields in Zeeman direction, this is large and this is small, plus minus 5/2, plus minus 1/2. And for fields perpendicular to this direction, this pattern looks completely different. That is what is described in EPR spectroscopy in rhombograms, for instance. And if we look for this situation for Mössbauer spectra, one can show relatively easy that each of these magnetic levels in the electronic shell now not only has a certain eigenvalue, but it has also a certain spin expectation value. Or in magnetochemistry, one would say each of these levels has a magnetic moment, a microscopic magnetic moment. So, and each of these microscopic magnetic moment generates a field at the nucleus. So that is the origin of these strong magnetic fields that we can see at paramagnetic compounds at low temperature. And each of these levels, in principle, generates its own Mössbauer spectrum, or if we are in the other extreme of magnetic relaxation, namely if the system, the electronic system, flips fast between these levels, then the average to one of these levels. So that we have a Boltzmann average of these magnetic moments to generate an internal field. And what we then record, or what we then see, is an internal field in Mössbauer spectroscopy. We cast this hyperfine interaction in terms of an internal field, which is vectorially added to the applied field. And this internal field has then different origin or has different mechanism by which it is mediated, by which the magnetic moment in the valence shell is transmitted to the nucleus. And the first one is this Fermi contact interaction, which has to do with different exchange interactions of alpha and beta electron in the inner core orbitals with the unpaired electron in the D shell. That is the same in EPR spectroscopy and I think also in NMR spectroscopy. And that is one of the strongest contribution usually in Mössbauer spectroscopy. There is then also a dipole contribution and the orbital contribution. That's the same in this different type of magnetic spectroscopies. And in Mössbauer spectroscopy, I mentioned that one here because that is also relevant then for the practicals. It's again the relaxation time. I said it in principle already. It depends on how fast the electronic system hops between the different magnetic levels of the electronic shell. Therefore, the hyperfine field can reverse. In the easiest case, it can reverse the sign fast or not so fast. Always with respect to the nuclear Lama precession time and the lifetime of the nucleus, and we get sharp lines only in the case of slow relaxation or fast relaxation. Intermediate relaxation makes ugly spectra, that is like broadening in the NMR spectra, and that usually is difficult to interpret in a reasonable manner. Spectra are looking like this one when we have relaxation properties, or can vary from sharp to broad to sharp again. I don't think that we will practice on these examples. I think in the practicals we will have examples of iron 3, and I don't know exactly what Alex is using, but we can always relate it to the EPR spectroscopy, so we can use the EPR properties to, let's say, to determine some of these parameters of the spin Hamiltonian, and then infer a magnetic Mössbauer spectrum. So the effect on the nucleus is then that we get contributions from the different MS levels, and one can disentangle this relatively complicated spectra into contributions from the different Kramer doublets, for instance, in the case of a weak magnetic field. So fields of 50 millitesla are sufficient to polarize this system, to make static conditions, and then we have this type of spectra. I think my time is running out. So then I would like to stop here and summarize in the sense that I say, I hope you understand that this is exotic, but also a little bit a cool technique. You have additional information in terms of this Mössbauer isomer shift, which is not reflected in NMR, not in, in EPR spectroscopy. And quadrupole interaction is also something which is not so easy, for instance, in EPR spectroscopy. And we can see all iron independent of the spin state, in contrast to EPR spectroscopy. And otherwise, we are a little bit blind when it comes to other isotopes, to other atoms. Nickel is possible, I said. But I should mention at the end that there is obviously, naturally now, also spectroscopy with synchrotron radiation. This was not trivial to achieve because synchrotrons typically yield white light, and Mössbauer spectroscopy needs extremely narrow, sharp lines. So filtering synchrotron radiation with double-slit crystals or so is hopeless. Then one ends up at 2 millielectron volt or so bandwidths. The trick in synchrotron Mössbauer spectroscopy is a time filtering. So this pre-filtered light is shooted on the sample. That makes a lot of excitation in the electronic shell, but also excitation of all the nuclear levels. But the electronic excitations decay much faster than the nuclear levels. So one has to wait something like 100 nanoseconds, and then the slow Mössbauer nuclei are coming and emitting, and then we get beating pattern, and that is then this time domain Mössbauer spectroscopy, which you eventually see in modern papers. Thank you for your attention.